this is why, you know, we use stories to teach children. Okay, fairy tales, all kinds of stories, and I'll refer to one of these stories. So let's look at the examples, the good, the bad, and the ugly. This is a spread from a Turkish Cypriot textbook. It was used until 2004. 2004, as we will see, is a break. Why? Because Çetebe comes to power and the textbooks change. This is one of the worst examples of textbooks, I would say, in all Cyprus, for many reasons. But let me focus on the main motif, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Okay, who is the good? The good are here, the fighters. But, you know, men with guns is not automatically good. Okay, they look rather very coarse or perhaps even aggressive. To show that they are the good, you have to have the actions of the enemy. So if this is what the Rums, the Greek Cypriots, were doing, then of course they are brave defenders of their people. And here are the ugly, where it says that the Turkish Cypriots were killed by the British in demonstrations in favor of Taksim, English barbarism. Okay, so this is the clear motif, and the content of the book is all about focusing on the Turkish heritage, okay, of Cyprus, so no discussion really of other kinds of heritages. Okay, denying origins, if you want, I'll discuss this more, because everybody has done this. The British have denied, let's say, identity or origins to Greek Cypriots, the Turkish Cypriots to Greek Cypriots, the Greek Cypriots to Turkish Cypriots. So if you want, later we can discuss this more. The idea that, basically, is the idea that what the others say they are not. And basically, it's the idea that they don't exist as a historical actor. But we can discuss this later. Okay, and basically, most of the book is focusing on this period, on 11 years. And of course, it legitimates the idea of Taksim. Let me move to another book now. Again, brave fighters, okay? Again, it's not clear on its own if these people are somehow, you know, good. They may just be, you know, aggressive. And this is a book actually not about the history of Cyprus, about the history of Greece, but it's used in the Greek Cypriot educational system. I'm using it because for me it's paradigmatic of these kinds of books. It's possibly the best paradigm you can find. So you have here the fighters, the Greek fighters. If they are going to be, you know, the good actor of the story, you need the barbaric enemy. Here are the Ottomans beheading, cutting the heads of Greek priests, okay, during the Ottoman period. And this, by the way, is a collage. They had to put two different images together and join them up. And for me, this is paradigmatic of the way we think and we teach history. First of all, remember two actors, protagonist, antagonist, two main actors, which is the structure of most stories. Then the protagonist in the front, okay, the antagonist in the back. In other words, ethnocentric stories. And stories of war, basically. Stories of fighting. Please continue, and then we'll see how we can figure this out. So remember the cover: protagonist in the foreground, antagonist in the back, and history is presented as a story of conflict. Again, this is very important. War is naturalized in these kinds of stories. In other words, war is presented as the motor of history, which is a very problematic assumption that, you know, history is basically a history of war and conflicts. And of course, there is something that is the most obvious about this cover. Now you don't have it in front of you, so it's maybe unfair of me to ask you. So I said that the story is ethnocentric, let's say war-centric, and there is another centric. I'm a social anthropologist, and this is something we like a lot, to finish something with centric. Could anybody guess what this may be? It's actually the most obvious aspect of the cover, but also the most invisible one. Okay, ethnocentric, ecocentric are very close. Androcentric. Okay, only men appear. And this again is a very classic characteristic of these kind of stories.
Victims could be female, though.
Yes.
Usually victims and children.
Yeah.
And this is why both sides, if you look at the imagery they use, is usually of women. Well, let me continue. The next book cover, I'll be using a lot of book covers, as you will see, is from the book on the history of Cyprus. And it's a book with ancient columns. So what does it say immediately, just the cover? Cyprus is Greek and nothing but Greek. Okay, and has always been Greek. And again, if you look at the content of the book, it says things like Cypriots are and have been Christian Orthodox, which of course denies the very presence of other groups. And it also focuses a lot on, let's say, links with Greece, of course, and it presents the Ottomans as barbarians who used to, I don't know, kill the Greeks in very horrible ways. What is mostly interesting about this book is that one day I was on television and I was discussing this book, and this was made in the mid-70s, the book I'll show you, with the Greek columns. And so I was discussing it and I was saying basically what I'm saying here, and what I did not no, was that the TV presenter put suddenly live the author of the book after I was saying these things. And this for me was one of the most remarkable experiences in my life, because this man who wrote this book in the 70s, he came out on television publicly and said, now I actually regret the work I did. It was this period when we were very much trying to boost, I don't know, national spirit and national consciousness, but now I see how selective my book is, and how I only refer, and this is kind of live, and I have a copy of this, which I discuss with my students whenever I show them, I make these kinds of presentations to them. So this for me was one of the most amazing things, that a historian reflected back on his own work and said, you know, I was so biased, and I'm rather ashamed to say this, and my work was so one-sided, and you know, it did not show the experiences of the other community, totally denied that anything had happened to them. Which brings us to the very idea of the story. The Greek Cypriot books usually start from the arrival of the ancient Greeks, Mycenaeans. So they start from maybe around the 12th century before Christ. And the protagonists there are the Greeks. So it's the idea that the nation exists or existed throughout history. They are the major antagonist in that story. Okay, this is the story of Cyprus is and has been Greek. Are the Ottomans, the Turks, the Ottomans, and then the Turks, and the Turkish Cypriots. When we say the Turks, they mean 74, but also 30 Cypriots before. And the end of the story is tragic. 1974 is a tragic end. The other history book I showed you has a different story. How does it start? It starts with the arrival of the Ottomans. Okay, so one side starts with the arrival of the Greeks, the other side with the arrival of the Ottomans, and now already we see how political the choice of the beginning of the story is. The main actor in that story are Turks, and of course they all make the assumption that Greeks and Turks existed, you know, throughout history. Not that nationalism or national identity is something that is a product of modernity.